scaling in ecology. So why is scaling so important and why you need to know about this? Well, scalings provide a way to deal with the diversity of scales and also the type, the different type of organism that exist and become part of ecological systems. Scaling makes apparent the fundamental similarity that underlies the diversity in nature and how this has been molded by the action of natural selection. It's very important to realize that scalings point out that there are not many ways of actually having a real functioning organism in nature, and provides you with the right way of understanding the constraints that are operating on diversity. And since most organisms obey these constraints, it points out to the fundamental similarity that they share. So the other important thing about the scaling is that it provides us with a benchmark against which we can compare different species, populations, and ecosystems, and you can actually measure deviations from scaling relationships, and those deviations means that there are some processes, some important biological processes operating on these systems. So let's start by the most simple way of characterizing scaling in ecology. And the characterization is a mathematical one, it's very simple. Usually scaling relationships, as you have already heard, cannot be summarized with a relationship like a variable y or a trait of an organism is proportional to a variable m raised to a power. In this case, I'm talking about m is the mass of the organism or the size of the system or the biological system. So you can also represent this relationship as y equals cm raised to alpha, or which actually allows you to take the logarithm of this relationship and transform something which is not linear into a linear equation. And I show you example of this in panel A. You see scaling relationships that are in the non-linearized way, and then to the right in panel B, you see the linear relationship that results after you take the logarithms of this relationship. That's make it easier to analyze. So examples of scaling abound in nature, and they affect the way organisms are put together and evolve through the action of natural selection. You can see, for example, relationships between the size of the organisms and winning time, or also the size of the organisms and longevity. And you can use this relationship, as I show you here in this panel, to compare different kind of organisms. For example, the gray dots represent all mammalian species, and the red dots represent one particular type of species, which are the marsupials. So you can see the marsupials, they in general, they follow the trend line for longevity, for example, but they deviate in maturation time, for example. So these scaling relationships allow you to compare, and you can use them as a benchmark to try to understand what is going on with this particular species that they deviate. Is this because of their phylogenetic history, or is it because of the environment, or the other kind of habits they have, what they eat on, and so on. So you can answer meaningful questions using the scaling relationships. In ecology, these relationships also affect, for example, things very fundamental like the average prey mass that a particular carnivore species will eventually eat, or affect, as you can see in the panel, the carbon turnover, or the time it takes to replace 1 gram of carbon in a particular ecosystem, and how that changed with the average mass of the plants in that ecosystem, or also you can see scaling relationship in terms of the net primary productivity of an ecosystem and the total amount of plant biomass in that ecosystem. So those are fundamental relationships that tell you something very, very general about the way organisms and ecosystem work. So how we understand the origin of this relationship? Well, let me tell you, the fundamental kind of a relationship, I would say, is the one that relates the organism and its energy requirement to its size. This is called the Kleber's law, and point out that the requirements of energy of an organism, its metabolism, which is the sum of all the biochemical reactions happening within the organism, scale with the size of the system or mass raised to a 3/4 power. And you can see in the graph that this relationship describes very well how metabolism changed as you increase the mass of organisms from a mouse, for example, to an elephant. And it tells you that somehow an elephant is just a variation on the same theme as a mouse is. So it's this relationship points out that there is a fundamental similarity among these different kind of organisms. So natural selection is not acting randomly, it follows some constraints. So what are those constraints? Well, in 1997, Geoffrey West, Jim Brown, and Brian Enquist, they propose a very simple and elegant model that point out to some fundamental principles acting and helping us to understand why metabolism changes in the way it does with the size of a system. And I'm not going to explain you all the details of the model. I'm just going to give you two major insights into it. Well, the major thing is that any organism that exists faces a problem, and the problem is that you have to deliver energy, the resources that you get from the environment to live, you have to deliver it to all the different parts of your body. In a multicellular organism, this means that you have to deliver this energy to all the cells in your body. So how you do that? Well, the way you do that is you construct. I mean, natural selection has molded the existence of networks to deliver this energy towards all the parts of your body. So those networks actually generate constraints that manifest in this fundamental 3/4 scaling for metabolism. Now, the way natural selection acts on this is by minimizing energy loss. So it generates networks that minimize this energy, so efficient networks. When you take account of what you consider these two major insights, and they show in a mathematical model that this creates the 3/4 scaling relationship that we see. So let me give you some example of the implications of this relationship in ecology. And one simple one is that you can ask a very simple question. It's like, what is the maximum number of individuals that you can be found in a given area? So to answer this question, which I think is a very fundamental one, you just require to know the amount of energy or resources that are in a particular area and the requirements of those resources by different kind of individuals. So the later we know that the scale with the size of the organisms rise through 3/4. So it's very simple then to compute the maximum number of individuals in a given area just by dividing the amount of resources over the requirements of each individual. And that's what that gives you is another scaling relationship that says that the maximum number of individuals scales with mass raised to -3/4. Now, let's see the empirical evidence. The empirical evidence on this, and I'm going to go back to a paper published by John Dammuth in 1981, where he makes a compilation of the density of different mammal species around the world. These happen to be herbivore mammals, and he computed the density and size of each of these species. And he plotted this relationship, and as you can see, there's a negative slope, and this slope is -3/4. So right as predicted, the maximum number of individuals follows a -3/4 scaling law. The implications of this are very interesting because it means that mice actually they achieve larger densities than elephants, but somehow they are the same because they, as I will show you, they use the same amount of energy at the population level. And how we can calculate that? Well, we call that the population energy use. Population energy use, PEU, is proportional to the number of individuals times the requirements for energy. So that will be the total amount of energy required by a population. And if we replace the known scaling relationships for number and for energy requirements, we know that population energy use will be proportional to mass raised to -3/4 times mass raised to 3/4. As you can see, these two exponents, they kind of annihilate themselves and give you a population energy use that is proportional to mass raised to 0, meaning that population energy use tend to be invariant regarding the size of the organisms, meaning that elephants use the same amount of energy that mice use. So this is a very fundamental invariant relationship. There are many more scaling relationships that show this kind of property of invariant, but show you that things can be different, but at the same time, things can be equal if you explore this relationship between the scalings. So why is fundamental, why is this very important too, is because it allows us to understand something about ourselves too. And here, I want to make the point that using this relationship, you can understand that humans are an hyperdense species. How we know that? Because we know the scaling relationship for all mammals. We know how density changes as you change the body size of the mammal. We are mammals. On average, a human being, you can consider it weighs around 70 kilos. And you can try to plot which would be the density that we should achieve if we will kind of following this relationship. And that our density will be around 2.12 individuals per square kilometer. So the realized density is 5.8 raised to 10 to 4, meaning 58,000 times larger. So this is a very significant deviation from the expected scaling relationship, and this is a very meaningful one because you can now answer how it comes, what happens to humans that they could achieve such an extreme maximum density as it does these days. Well, let me tell you that when we were in a different kind of stage of development, social state of development, when we were hunter-gatherer, we really fit into this relationship. As we move through time and social complexity, we were moving away from this relationship, and now we are far away from it, and this has impact in terms of the amount of energy that we use and the impact of that amount of energy used by humans on the rest of the ecosystem. That is called, or is part of what we call global change. We're not going to deal with this in this class, but it's important to keep it in mind. That is why scaling relationships help you to realize there are similarities, there are fundamental principles related to the way organisms deliver energy through networks that explain the amount of energy that different organisms require, and this constrain the density and the amount of energy their population use. And this, you can use them to understand deviations like the human's density, extreme or hyperdensity of human now.